Welcome to the Bruins Benders Podcast, Season 2, Episode 1, Bruins Season Preview with Maddie and Smitty, brought to you on the Inside the Rink Podcast Network. InsideTheRink.com is your one-stop shop for all your NHL news, insight, and analysis. Follow on Twitter at @inside_the_rink and download the new Inside the Rink app to get everything on the website right on your phone. And now Smitty has a quick word from show sponsor and friends of Inside the Rink, BetUS.
BetUS has your NHL, NBA, UFC, PGA, and NFL betting lines up for their 28th year of live betting. Sign up at BetUS.com with the promo code RINK for 125% sign-up bonus. Again, that is BETUS.com, and use the promo code RINK for your sign-up bonus. Play with the proven mainstay in the industry. BetUS, you bet, you win. You get paid. BetUS.com.
Do we get paid? Do we get paid?
Maybe.
I think we do a little bit. Yeah. Sure. Maybe we should play more. You have to. Yep. Yeah. In order to get paid, you have to play.
You do have to do that. Me.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's true. Hey, season premiere of the Bruins Benders podcast and our Bruins season preview coming up. But first, prospect challenge recap. The Bruins prospects were in the challenge in Buffalo, 16 little round robin tournament, and the Bruins coming in with the 32nd best prospect pool in the league, and had a pretty good showing. Won 2 games in the challenge.
They did. They had a pretty good showing. They had some guys that looked pretty good. Fabian Lysell being chief among them. Mm-hmm. Had a pretty good tournament. Luke Toporowski had a pretty good tournament. Mm-hmm. Some of the young defensive guys had decent tournaments. I can't think of any of the names.
Well, John Beecher had a really good tournament. And, you know, there's talk now that maybe he's a little bit better than people might have thought. You know, and had him sort of as a bottom six NHL, you know, forward, because didn't have, you know, great finishing touch, has great speed, great size, really, you know, hunts the puck and plays hard. But, you know, people thought maybe one of those guys that's just going to have kind of stone hands and do everything well, except for putting it in the net. But he's been doing that some, especially in the challenge. So maybe there's a guy, maybe not right away this year, but soon, that'll be able to be a really good bottom six guy for at least the next 4 or 5 years.
Yeah. I think he gained some confidence in that tournament. And I think that's carried over for him a little bit into the full camp here, and he's been playing pretty well. So you know, big body, skates well, is a center, which is a plus, takes faceoffs, is winning faceoffs, he penalty kills. So you have a big guy who can win draws and kill penalties, you know, in your bottom six, you're gonna have an NHL career for a long time.
Yeah, you certainly are. So that was I guess a little more promising. And now that we see now in the preseason, the first couple of games, you know, we have a couple of other guys, younger guys. You know, obviously AJ Greer had the overtime goal in game 2 of the preseason. Jack Stanica had 2 assists. You know, Oscar Steen scored a goal. So, you know, maybe some of those young, maybe the prospect pool is improving some, and there is something there for the team, you know, going forward. I will say this though: new coach, new outlook. You know, guys seem like they probably have some freedom and a second chance. So we'll just see if that's just a novelty and it wears off and they're back to who we thought they were, or if it's actually something coming down the line. But I think it's a good sign anyway. I thought Stadnicka was okay in the first game. Not great in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Showed a little bit later. But then in game 2, I thought he played better. There's just times when it just doesn't seem like, and I don't really want to call it effort, but it almost seems like there's not a ton of effort. Second effort. There were 3 or 4 passes in game 1 of the preseason where he just doesn't catch the pass. It's just right. He just doesn't catch it. Like, yeah, and I don't know what it is.
It's a big thing for young players, and part of the reason that some guys, you know, develop and are good, and some guys aren't. You know, you figure out. Some guys takes longer than others, but you figure out at an early age or early in your career, you know, I have to play this way all the time to stay in the league. And some guys figure it out and some guys don't. And the guys that don't bounce up and down and have some issues. And, you know, you wonder if there's effort and, you know, it might not be that. It might be, you know, they're not feeling as good as they would. You know, they took some hits or whatever it is, whatever the case may be. But professionals fight through that and give you the same effort night in and night out. That's why Marchand is so good, because he's always on. You don't see Marchand. He might not play well, but he's going to give you an honest effort every single night. Same with Bergeron. Same with the, you know, the top guys in the league. That's what you get from them. That's why they're the top guys in the league, is because every single night they show up.
They do. And I think with AJ Greer as a guy, you know, who played at BU a little bit, was a draft pick in that 2015 draft. You know, has some scoring ability in some of the levels he played in. He's also a guy who will fight and will be chippy and a little nasty and not back down, which he showed the other night. And a guy that really puts some pressure on someone like Thomas Nosek, because, you know, I don't know if they'll really need Nosek for what he does, which, again, in the first preseason game, wasn't great. Like, it just wasn't great.
I mean, to me, he puts pressure on a guy like Trent Frederick. Like,
sure.
He plays how Trent Frederick should play. He hits everything that moves. He scores some goals. He's feisty. He agitates. He'll drop the gloves. He, you know, he is giving the effort that Frederick should give. Mm-hmm. And right now, if it was up to me, Greer's on the team and Frederick is not, based off of, you know, a handful, you know, a couple of preseason games. But if I was making the decision, that's what I'm going with. I'm going with the guy who's going to give me the effort and plow through guys and cause havoc and give me some energy. Like, the crowd was all into it. You know, that's what you need out of your bottom six guys. You need energy. You need them to lift the rest of the bench up. That's what you need from. So, I mean, like I said, it's only a couple of games, but as of right now, that's what I'm taking him. I'm putting him on the third line.
You know, and Jim Montgomery said the same thing. He said, if the season started today, Greer's in the lineup. Yeah. And today I saw in the practice lines that Greer was playing with Coyle and Smith, just like you just said.
There you go.
So, and Frederick wasn't great in the second preseason game.
He was not.
And, you know, Greer plays left wing. And we've talked about Trent Frederick all season long. If you want to go back to season one of the Bruins Benders podcast, he was a whipping boy. He was a guy that we talked about all year long that had to play a certain way. Like you just said, he's a perfect example of the guy who has to play a certain way to stay in the league. Mm-hmm. And there were times when he wasn't.
No.
And he would get benched. And he would get scratched. And he would, you know, not be playing on a given night. And now a guy like AJ Greer comes in. He had a wicked snipe in the overtime.
Yeah.
He had a tremendous move. It didn't score, but he went around a guy.
Yeah. A little slow drag around
him.
To
get a shot off. Oh, my goodness. That was
he
a really
good play. He scored
earlier
in the game, too. He had two goals. He had two goals. Seven hits in 13 minutes.
Yeah.
Two
goals and a fight.
And almost a fight.
Oh yeah, almost a fight. Yeah, yeah. Did he fight the first game? He did. Right?
Yeah, he did fight the first.
Yeah, he did fight the first game. So yeah, I mean, he's exactly what you said. He's exactly what Trent Frederick should be. And now I think Montgomery has seen that and really likes what he sees from Greer. And I think unless something happens, I think Greer's going to make the team.
It certainly looks that way.
It'll be interesting to see what happens with Trent Frederick, who's on the last year of a $1 million deal. So.
And Greer is endearing himself to the fan base. He knows how the fans in this town want players like him to play. He knows. He's been here. He played at BU, like you said before. And he said in the media afterwards that he models himself after Milan Lucic.
Which is going to endear him to everybody.
Absolutely endear him to the people. Because the people have been claiming for the real Lucic to come back
11 years later. Yeah.
So if you can get a guy that's, you know, 25 going on 26 years old to come in and play like that, you know, they're going to love him. I mean, he's going to be a cult hero in Boston.
In that post-game interview, you could see how happy he was to be wearing the Bruins. He said it a couple of times that to put the emblem on, to put the sweater on, you know, to play in Boston. And he thrives, looks like a guy who thrives on, like you said, the fan reaction to what he does.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he likes to do and is willing to do. Then God bless him. He is going. And that could be a really good pickup from Sweeney. And it'll be interesting to see as we go if Sweeney can gain some level of trust or regain some respect from fans if some of these prospects that he's bringing in actually are able to do something. All right, Seven Chirps Time is sponsored by Lops Brewing. Lops is a brewery and tasting room in downtown Woonsocket, Rhode Island, specializing in small batch ales and lagers. It's open 7 days a week, and you can use the coupon code SPORTS to get 10% off your online order. Go to lopsbrewing.com and also follow them on social media at Lops Brewing for new beers and events. And chirp number one, Zdeno Chara retires a Bruin, signs a one-day deal to be a Bruin and retire, and they will have a ceremonial puck drop on October 22nd against the Minnesota Wild for Chara. I guess your opinion or your thoughts on his legacy with the Bruins.
Well, I think it all started kind of with him and Savard to change the culture. When he got to the Bruins, it was kind of a mess. Like they were, borderline last place kind of team. They were just, they didn't really have the leadership that you would want them to have. And they kind of weren't getting any free agents. And, that was kind of a big deal. He comes in, signs a big contract to be the captain. Savard comes in and it really kind of changed the whole entire culture and the feeling around the team. So to me, that's his legacy, is the teams that you have seen going forward have his stamp on them for the way that he created the culture that still exists now. And, obviously the cup win in 11, is huge and that should be noted and Norris trophies and old trophy and final Norris finalists and that kind of thing. Like he's been just a steady rock pillar, great guy, deserves all the accolades he gets, really, and is everything that you would want in a Bruins captain, I feel like.
And I agree. And in 2006, I think that was shortly after the Dave Lewis miserable year there. Yeah. I mean, they were in the tank, and they had not really, as we've known growing up, not really spent the extra money. And at the time, those were market deals. Those were like big market, like top of the market deals mm-hmm. that they hadn't done in the past. And they go and get Chara and Savard, who also Savard, although his career was cut short, also, a good pro and a good Bruin and gave his all and that type of thing. So that did change the culture 100%. And he also did, little subtle things like, not letting rookies be mistreated. Like, anybody who made the team was a professional hockey player and were to be treated as such. And that's part of the culture that was kind of brought in. So when you had guys like, and I know he had problems here, but Tyler Seguin, Brad Marchand was a rookie in 11. Like those guys were able to be a part of the team and a big part of the team and didn't have to worry about, being mistreated by veteran guys, and which can happen and, in different sports at different levels. So Chara did change the whole sort of landscape. And Bergeron was in his third or fourth season, so he was still young, still only 21, 22 years old. And Chara was able to really put his stamp on it. And 5 years later, in 2010, 4 years later, they should have won the cup, I still think, because when Krejci got hurt, that sort of killed that thought of them winning. And then 2011, they win. So within 4 to 5 years, they're a top team in the league. And it wasn't all him, but it was certainly him starting that culture. So it's good for him to, good to see him having his day and being back with the Bruins, which he should be. And I think there'll be a number of retirement at some point.
Yeah.
I'm sure the puck drop is just something to recognize it now. And then later on, there'll be a bigger night, I'm sure, with his 33 going to the rafters. Chirp number two, should Fabian Lysell start the season in the Western Hockey League, Providence or Boston?
I believe he should start in Providence. And I feel like he should play probably the entire season there, unless he's really tearing it up late in the season or if the Bruins are, just killed with injuries. I feel like he needs to get stronger. I think he gets pushed around a little bit now. And it's still just preseason games. And so the speed's going to ramp up again once it hits the regular season. So I feel like he could use kind of a full season worth of seasoning at the AHL level before he kind of comes to the Bruins full time.
I think so too. And I look back at some of the Western Hockey League, some of the players, like good players in the past who played in the Western Hockey League, and many of them played multiple years there. You know, Jerome McGinley played four seasons in the Western Hockey League. The only guy I could see that played 1 year and then became like, you know, really good player was Duncan Keith, who just retired. So, but all, a lot of them played 2 to 3 to 4 years. Like Lucic was in that too, like playing several years in the Western Hockey League. So I'm with you. I think there's a couple of things going for Lysell right now. And one is the type of game NHL is right now with speed and finesse and all that, where he can do it undersized at, in a pro, at the Providence level. And I agree with you. He probably should be there. And also the need for the organization to hang their hat top prospect and show him at the pro level. Like there's, it, this is not a team that has the time for that. And I think you put him in Providence to really kind of push the envelope, because I think you need some positivity from your prospect pool. You need to show, you know, the hockey world that you do have some prospects here, and here's your top prospect, and he is going to be a player. So I think there's a little bit of urgency there too. I mean, does that make sense? I think that's it. And I'm with you. Play him there the whole year. I think I saw some really good things for him in the first preseason game, but also there's still, you could also see that it's probably, he's probably not there yet either. And there was some,
I mean, there was some passes and stuff that he made that, you know, at the NHL level, he's not going to be able to get away with that. He could get away with it in a preseason game, but he's not going to be able to get away with it at the NHL level when it's, you know, bullets are flying for real. So I feel like he has some things to work on, some things to clean up, but you can see it. I mean, the speed is there, the skill is there, the hands are there, you know, the vision, all that stuff is there, the creativity. But he just needs, you know, he needs a little more time to develop and a little more time to get stronger. And I think a year in the AHL will do him well.
And I think that first preseason game where they had some power plays early, he had some really good possession in the zone. He looked like he knew what he was doing. He looked like he had some confidence there. And there were some pretty good power plays with him sort of in the lead there and possessing the puck quite a bit. So that was a good sign as well. Chip 3, Brandon Carlo comments in The Athletic about loving hockey again. So this is kind of beautiful. So Brandon Carlo says that he had a miserable time last year. He just loves going to the rink again and so forth and so on. And actually made a comment that, you know, it's nice to not have to go to the bench and on the way to the bench, getting an earful on the way to the bench. So I think there was we talk about DeBrusque and Cassidy, and we talk about Frederick and Cassidy and younger guys, and Stadnik and Cassidy, Sinishin, but Carlo might have been one of the real top culprits in all of this.
I think you're right. I think that could be a big reason why he had a regression. Because he just felt like anytime he did something wrong, he was going to hear about it immediately. You know, he didn't have the freedom to just play and make a mistake. So I think maybe when he was younger, they cut him some slack on that. And as he became more of a veteran and a leader on the team, because he does wear the A sometimes, that, you know, they were kind of hammering on him. You know, you can't keep doing this or whatever the case may be. And I think it probably grates on you after a while. It would me, you know, sure. Every time you come off the ice, someone's yelling at you like, you suck, you know, right. you can't right. keep turning the fucking puck. Like that's going to grind you down. Sure. So, being able to have a clean slate with a new coach, I think, certainly will help him. And maybe we'll get him back to the form he showed a few years ago when he was a shutdown guy. I did notice that a few times during some of the preseason games that he really jumped up in the play. I mean, he's always been a great skater. So if you can get a little bit more out of him offensively and he returns to that shutdown form, I think, you know, the Bruins will be in pretty good shape when they, you know, get McAvoy back.
It does make sense now when he severely regressed offensively, like severely.
Yeah.
So he would not make those, risky plays because he knew he'd get an earful or so forth. And right. I think also Cassidy kind of figured out who Carlo was, and it frustrated him. Like, it you know, look, you're a big strapping dude. You're either going to jump in the play and be give us a little bit of offense, or if you're going to be stay at home, you're going to pound people. Like, you can't be in between. You can't do neither.
Right.
And I think that that's probably what got Cassidy's ire there. But it was interesting, the comments. And then there was also Stadnica, who said, you know, I just didn't want to go to the rink anymore. And I didn't. And I'm like, Jesus, you know, what the hell was Cassidy doing to these guys? Like, you think, like, yeah, this is a little over the top, dude. Like, I can't imagine that it was so bad that these guys were just like puddles after yeah, what was going on. But Cassidy was probably frustrated. He said, he's probably thinking, Sweeney, give me these young guys who can't play, and I'm just going to rip them a new asshole,
right,
you know, every time, because it's just not working out.
Yeah, I mean, to me, it's, and like, we didn't really see it with Cassidy because he was great with the media, and he kind of told it like it was or like it is, and everybody kind of ate that up. But if you look back now, like, Krejci left, Jabresk mm-hmm. wanted to be traded, Stanika was miserable, you know, Carlo miserable, like, the list is kind of growing, kind of bigger. Who was it? Bacchus didn't see eye to eye with them.
Right. True.
You know, the list is longer than we thought. Like, we're like, oh, it was just a Nico, just a Brust. Like, what the hell's up with them? But, you know, now some more stuff got starting to come out, and you're like, well, maybe he was grating on everybody, and, you know, some guys could just handle it better. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as we've said before, you coach in the league long enough, your message starts to run stale. And it certainly appeared as though, at the end, the message from Cassidy had run stale with this group.
Yeah, and Grizzlick, there was Grizzlick too. There was a rumor about Grizzlick and how he was treating him and talking to him. So I think it started as DeBrusk has a problem and wants to leave, and everybody kind of get on DeBrusk like, come on, like, you want to leave, then go. And even we did that on episodes here. Yeah. We're like, you got to trade the guy. He doesn't want to be here, screw him. Yeah. But now there's like 10 guys, you know, that were going to leave or wanted to leave or didn't want to come to the rink. So now, hopefully, Montgomery. Now, there's a fine line there. You don't want to be too soft,
right,
that the team is just not motivated or not held accountable. But I think it will help the team in the beginning, and maybe we will get something out of these couple guys. I still don't think Stadnica is an everyday NHL player that's going to be all that productive, because if you look at his stats in other levels, not super duper, not stupendous, you know. So I don't think it's going to happen for him. But maybe there are some other guys coming up that will be a little more comfortable playing, you know, from a young age and given a little bit more leash. You know, that's another thing. You know, not being scratched after three games because you had 7 minutes of ice time because you were sat for the third period. So that's that thing too. Chirp 4, why isn't Taylor Hall seen as a core piece of the team? He's a former league MVP, but he just really isn't mentioned much when you talk about the core. And it's true.
I don't really know the answer to that. It's kind of surprising to me. I mean, he put up what, third or fourth most points on the team last year?
60. Yeah.
You know, he had a good year. But when everybody talks about the core of the team, it's like McAvoy, Pastrnak, Swayman, you know, Lindholm, whatever. Those guys are signed. Like, Hall's signed. Nobody mentions him, though. Like, yeah. I'm not sure why. I'm really not. I mean, is it because he, you know, is a little streaky, comes and goes? Is he hasn't been on the team long enough? Like, I'm not 100% sure why that is.
Here's why I don't trust him. And I don't trust him because his career has been largely, well, maybe not largely, but somewhat underachieving. And it's in at times, like, he's had run-ins with teams where he eventually, you know, has a great year and then eventually doesn't have a very good year. And it's kind of ebbs and flows with him. And it's not, you know, people thought he was going to be one of the top players in the league. Like, he was a dynamic player coming into the draft, and he hasn't been on that level of, you know, high first round, first overall picks. He hasn't been to that level consistently. And you talked about streakiness. I feel it's more, there's a lack of trust with me that he just doesn't have the consistency or doesn't give what you think he's going to give. He's kind of fool's gold. Like you think you just keep waiting for Taylor Hall to have a 45 goal season and just be dynamic and great. And he just doesn't get there. But you see flashes of him on the ice where you're like, wow, what a play by Hall. But then you won't see that for six games. I think there's just this feeling that he's going to let you down at the end of the day. And I think that's part of it. And the other part of it is that some of the core was drafted here and he's kind of the guy who they brought in. So maybe that's part of it too, where they drafted these other guys. So they're kind of the core and he's an outlier like a coil where he's kind of an added piece. And I'm not sure. I'm just not sure what Bruins fans really feel about him. He's good and he can be great, but I just feel like he's, like you said, the eighth guy you mentioned on the team.
Just like slightly disappointing kind of a thing where he hasn't played up to his full potential
kind of the JD Drew of the Bruins. Where he's just like, this guy is a number one pick. This guy has all the tools. This guy is just terrific. And then there's a couple of games where you're like, wow, this guy is as good as we thought he was. And then 10 games later, you're like, what happened? You know, that 3 weeks ago, he was really good. And it's kind of that same thing. Like there's this undertone of he's going to kind of let you down. And it doesn't happen every day. And if you're not like you said about Martian, if you're not an everyday guy, Boston fans don't get behind you, you know, and I think that's part of it. There's a little bit of prima donna to his deal. You know what I mean? I don't know. There's just a little bit of, I don't know how much of a real grinder he is night to night, like a Martian is. We said this before, you could be, you know, you could hit 270, but if you slide in the third with your pants on fire, then everybody's going to love you. You know, if you're if people like Trot Nixon over Manny Ramirez in Boston, people like, you know, Dirt Dog, they like PJ Stock over David Krejci. You know, that's just the way Boston is. Blue collar, Dirt Dog, give it everything you have, you know, put your body on the line. They'll love you to a point. And if you're not that, they won't. They won't let you in the fraternity, so to speak. So I think maybe that's part of it with Hall. I'm not 100% sure. And it'll be interesting to see how much longer he'll be a Bruin and how that'll play out. I don't know. All right, Chirp 5. Five things that need to go right for the Bruins to make the playoffs.
Okay. So can't have any more injuries. One.
Okay. That's one.
I don't know, one, you can call it 1A, you can call it 2. I don't know how many things I'll throw on the list, whatever. But they need to get the guys that are injured back and those guys need to perform. So, you know, McAvoy needs to come back and be himself. Marchand needs to come back and be himself. Grizzly needs to come back and be himself. Like those guys need to come back and play well. So there's those two things. I think depth scoring is always there. So, you know, that coil line, you know, coil, like Smith has to rebound, you know, that third line has to be, an offensive threat. It can't just be out there sucking up minutes and being a black hole and not really creating anything. It needs to, you know, the depth forwards need to give them some offense. Four, I would say offense from the defenseman other than McAvoy. Like you need to have other guys chip in. A full year at Lindholm, I think, will help that. A little more freedom from Riley if he's around will help that. I think Zaboral was showing flashes before he got hurt last year, so I think that'll help. I think Carlo getting some freedom, getting the monkey off his back, you know, Cassidy off his back and giving him a little more room to breathe. I think that could help. So, and I think Stroman is, we haven't talked about this yet, but I think he's going to be a really nice addition to the team because I think he's so steady and he makes such a good first pass out of the zone. He's smart. He's played a ton of games. He's been through playoffs, you know, all the way through the Stanley Cup finals. So you know, I think some of the depth pieces they have now, I think, are better than they have been in the past. Like your, you know, seventh, eighth defenseman guy. I think your forwards that are competing for the bottom six roles, that fourth line roles. I think you have more guys there that if you did lose some guys, you have guys that you could plug in and be like, oh, that's not a huge drop off. Right. So I think they have a little more depth there that will help. And finally, it's goaltending. It always will be goaltending. The goaltending needs to play well. Swayman has to improve on last year. He needs to control his rebounds better. He needs to handle the puck better. And then Allmark just needs to continue to be solid. So I would say if those things all work in their favor, I think they're a playoff team.
And I do too. And I think obviously a big part of the whole thing is how David Krejci will play after missing a year in the NHL and having it be, I mean, he played in a league that was, you know, it was sort of easier for him. Now he's coming back to the NHL where it's, you know, it can get away from you pretty quick. So it'd be interesting to see for me how David Krejci performs throughout the season. Injuries are obviously the big thing. When you're a slightly older team, mm-hmm. you always have the risk of more injuries. You've already had some. You have guys with repair jobs all over the place that could get re-injured or so forth. So that's always scary. Goaltending is huge. And I think the defenseman chipping in offensively is such a sneaky important thing for them, because back in the day in 2011, I think we said they had, I can't remember 100 and, or I can't remember how many points, but it was a lot of points in the postseason from the defense all the way down to Ferentz, yeah. like everybody. Yeah. Guys had goals, everything. And they didn't have a lot of that at all last year. Their defensive points after McAvoy were pretty much non-existent. So I think Lindholm will help. Strom will help with more assists probably because of his good passing and such and so forth. But guys like Carlo and Saboril have to be able to chip in too and step up and step in to make plays. And I think, you know, secondary, if Smith isn't getting it done and Foligno isn't getting it done in these guys, then you got to see Greer and you got to see McLaughlin. You got to see these other guys. And maybe you just send Smith somewhere. He's on the last year of his deal. You're going to probably lose him anyway. I don't think you're going to re-sign him unless he has a good year. So if he's not having a good year, I think you give his spot to someone else, some younger guy. And I'd rather see a younger guy with his ups and downs than Craig Smith out there invisible, to be quite honest. So those are all important factors for sure for the Bruins. I think right now, I think they're on paper a better team than people are giving them credit for.
But there's
a lot of risk factors in there. Like in a perfect world, I think they can win the division. I do.
I would agree with you.
But in an imperfect world, they could have a real disastrous middle of the year too.
So, yeah, I mean, if they get off to a bad start and Marchand doesn't come back the same way, and like it could go downhill in a hurry.
Sure.
Really could.
It really could. And you don't really have the prospects in there to float in there. So if it goes downhill, it's going all the way down the hill. And, you know, that's what some Bruins fans want. They wanted the rebuild. They may get a rebuild by default. All right. Chirp number six, five things that could cause the Bruins to miss the playoffs.
So injuries. Yeah. Yeah. The injuries are already there. But if they lose anybody else in the early part of that season, like if someone else goes down and then you're missing, you know, those three guys and then other guys, like it could go bad in a hurry. So injuries is big. You know, Krejci comes back and he's just not the same guy. I mean, that it could be that. Right. It could be some of these defensemen, you know, jump up in the play and we're giving up, you know, all kinds of two-on-ones and we're getting scored on and we're just giving up way more goals than we're used to giving up. So it could be, you know, a defensive philosophy change that could come back to bite you, you know, if you're not smart about it. So I think that's something that could derail them a little bit. You know, the secondary scoring, it was kind of non-existent last year. And if it stays that way, you know, that's going to derail you. You can't expect, you know, Marchand, Bergeron, Pastrnak to bail you out all the time. You know, mm-hmm. it was last year when those guys didn't score, the Bruins didn't win. So if the secondary scoring lets you down, you know, you're going to be on the outside looking in. And then the competition within the division is much better. So, you know, Ottawa's improved, obviously. Detroit's improved. Montreal is young and probably not very good, but still improved. Mm-hmm. You know, all these teams in your division have gotten better, maybe with the exception of Florida, who lost a couple of key pieces, you know, in Huberdeau and Uyghur, and then lost Giroux after the trade deadline. So, mm-hmm. You know, you lose some of those guys and, you know, Tampa's a little bit older and has had to, you know, say goodbye to some guys, but, you know, still, obviously those teams are still towards the top of the division. So I think the division as a whole is tougher. So, you know, it's going to be a grind, especially with guys hurt early in the season. So I think all those things could play a factor into them missing the playoffs.
Yeah. I mean, goaltending is definitely.
Yeah. And that's important. True.
That's, I mean, if that fails in some way, and I don't think it will. I mean, they have some pretty good security there with two decent goaltenders, but you know, someone gets hurt and the other guy doesn't play well, then yeah, that could send you in a tailspin too. If you're not figuring out the bottom six, if they're not getting it done, if Charlie Coyle has a bad year, I mean, that's not great either. So he needs to have a good year with potentially as the year goes forward and it's completely healthy. He could have Zacha and Smith on his line. He should do well. You know what I mean? He should, you know, or someone like that. I mean, he should be doing pretty well with the players he has. And that should be a line that should, as it goes forward. And if Zacha's moved down to the third line, then that's a line that can do some damage. But, all right. So that leads us into chirp number 7. Last year we did bold predictions and I had DeBrusque with 25 goals and hit it. And you had Marchand win in the heart, and you might have if he didn't hit other people illegally. So, yeah. So what is your bold prediction for this year?
My bold prediction this year is that the Bruins are going to have 8 guys who score 20 goals.
Okay. Okay. So you figure Marchand, Bergeron, DeBrusque.
Paul, Pastrnak,
Krejci.
Smith. And Smith, let's say... Zacha, sure.
Miss Zacha. Okay. So everyone essentially but Charlie Coyle scores 20.
Yeah, I don't think Coyle, because he doesn't shoot the puck.
He doesn't shoot the puck enough. No.
No.
But yeah, I mean that's possible. I mean is possible.
Yeah, I think they're gonna have balance. I think they're gonna have better balance scoring overall, and I think that will help them get into the playoffs.
Okay. My bold prediction, I have DeBrusque with 25. I'm gonna stay with a 25 and go Pavel Zacha 25 goals.
Okay.
This year. And my other bold prediction beyond this year, this is not Patrice Bergeron's last year.
I tend to agree, and I
would almost say if things go well, I almost think it's not Bergeron or Krejci's last year. And I think they get one more bridge year before the young guys come up of those two centermen for next year as well.
I could see that. I could see that.
I see that coming down the pipeline. Again, without injuries, without disaster, without those things, I see that happening next year. But we'll see. All right. And lastly, Bruins with 4 players in the NHL Network Top 50. And it was Charlie McAvoy at 27, Pastrnak at 26, Marchand at 23, Bergeron at 22.
Oh, I mean, that sounds about right.
That Bergeron is just now what could be his last year is the top 22.
Yeah, I mean, I probably would put Marchand higher. I probably would put Marchand in the top 20 because I think he's probably one of the top 2 or 3 left wings in the entire league. So mm-hmm. I would probably put him in the top 20. But Bergeron had an unbelievable year. I mean, he really did.
He had one of his best years as a pro.
Yeah. So, it's hard to argue with the rankings. I mean, McAvoy maybe should be a little bit higher too, because he was, you know, he was a finalist for the Norris or fourth or whatever it was. Fourth, right?
Right. Yeah.
He's probably right about where he should be.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was what? It was Makar, Yossi, and then Hedman, and then McAvoy.
And then Hedman, and then Fox, right?
So no, McAvoy was higher. I think McAvoy finished above Fox.
Above Fox, right. That's what I meant. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I think it's about where they should be overall. Maybe Marchand a little bit higher, and Pasternak had, you know, kind of a slow little bit there, and then he turned it on. So
yeah,
I would say that they're probably where they should be for the most part.
So if you have four guys in the top 50, that's a pretty good team.
Four guys in the top 30.
Four guys in the top 28.
Right.
Yeah. You have four guys in the top 28 in the league. That's pretty good. I mean, there's 32 teams in the league.
Yeah.
So that's pretty good. And that means you have a pretty good team. And again, if they're all healthy.
Right. Two of them aren't going to be there to start.
Two of them aren't healthy. But yeah, I mean, as the year goes on, that's four in the top 28. That's really, really good. So I don't know. I think next week we'll have our NHL predictions, and we'll do that thing with the standings and who we think will win and all of that. But I think that if things go well, I think this is a talented team. I think this is a really talented team. And I don't know. I know there's some Bruins fans who don't want to admit it, but it is. And you know, are they as talented to get to the Stanley Cup Finals or any of that? I don't know, but I think that they're pretty good.
I think, think things fall the right way for them. You know, they'll be a really solid team all the way around. Like, you know, Krejci certainly helps. That gives them a little bit more depth and playmaking that they haven't had. You know, Holla did an admirable job filling in there, but he's not the playmaker that Krejci is. You know, you add Zaka in, who's another big body. Mm. You know, if Zboril can have kind of a breakout season, which it looked like he was doing before the injury, you know, they have some pieces that could give them a really solid team, you know, all the way through their lineup. Yeah. So I do think they're a better team than they were last year. Now, whether that, you know, ends up working out, you know, on paper or whatever, then, you know, we'll see. But I think they have more talent than they did a year ago.
And I think that, I think the power play will be better. Hopefully, especially with Krejci in there, I think it'll be better. It has to be. The thing I'm going to take a real look at though is the penalty kill, because if you have some younger bottom six guys, I'm not sure how much penalty killing time you want to give a guy like Bergeron all season long. So, penalty kill might be a sneaky little thing, for people. So we'll have to take a look at that. Or go to theinsidetherink.com for Bruins Benders merchandise. Go ahead and buy some merch from us. Follow us at Bruins Benders on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. Download the Inside the Rink app. Next week, we'll do NHL predictions and look at some over-unders for you betting fools. And this year, we'll do Benders again. So that'll be fun. And we'll do some other little things as well. We appreciate everyone listening. And this is the Bruins season preview. We will see you all very soon. Thanks a lot for listening.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.